In the workshop today is a Hyundai Kona Electric, and in this video I'm just going to show you what's underneath and we'll have a look under the bonnet as well. So this model is a 2019 with a 64 kilowatt hour battery pack. So let's just flick the bonnet open. So if you're not used to electric vehicles, you would look under this bonnet and think that was a petrol engine. Because with these, it's all up front and you have this plastic cover over the top and it looks very similar to an internal combustion engine. But of course it's not. That is an electric motor. Well, it's an electric motor at the bottom and then all the power electronics sit above it in sort of aluminium enclosures and it's all water cooled. So the whole motor stack is about the same size as, say, a 1.6 petrol engine. So, first off, let's talk about this, a 12-volt battery. So, all EVs have 12-volt batteries, just like combustion engine vehicles. And just like a combustion engine vehicle, the 12-volt battery is needed to start the vehicle. But obviously, it's not cranking over an engine. But when you come up to your vehicle, you need to have power to operate the central locking, unlock the doors, and then turn on the dash, push the start-stop button, and that then turns on the vehicle. So at that point, there's no high voltage power coming from the battery, and that's why you need a 12-volt battery. That is powering all the ECUs to allow you to unlock and start the car. And just like a combustion engine vehicle, if this battery is low or flat, you cannot start your car. You won't be able to unlock the doors, and you won't be able to turn on the high voltage battery. And in a scenario like that, you can do exactly the same as you would with a combustion engine vehicle. You could connect jump leads up to it and jump it from another vehicle. You could connect up a mains charger and charge it, or you can put a boost pack on it and get it going that way. This is actually my first time looking under the bonnet on a Kona. I've never actually had a Kona in before. But with all electric vehicles and hybrids, anything that is orange is high voltage. So in this case we've got three orange cables here and they're coming from the charge port at the front there. And then there's also this cable here with a pull out top, and I'd imagine that is your emergency release to release this if there's no power. So let's pull off this cover like that, and then you can see the electric motor. Well, as I said, the electric motor's at the bottom. So what you've got here is an electric motor driving the front wheels, because this is a front wheel drive car, and then bolted above the electric motor will be your inverter and charger units, and these are all aluminium enclosures and they're all water cooled. So we've got hoses going in and out of every block and also going through the radiator, and then there's your coolant bottle. So I guess this top unit is your inverter, or is it the charger? They're often the same thing actually. It would be one box doing all the power of electronics. I can see on there it says 7.2 kilowatt, so the 7.2 kilowatt is the AC charging speed. So that's what that is. I'm not sure what this is. As I said, I haven't seen one of these before, and I'm not going to go in too depth here and start taking anything apart. But it's probably pretty similar to the Ioniq, which I have done videos looking under the bonnet of those vehicles before. And even though this is a 64 kilowatt hour battery, this is very similar to a Hyundai Ioniq 38 kilowatt hour. The battery is water cooled, and some of these vehicles have had the same recall that all the 38 kilowatt hour Ioniqs have had, because they use the wrong coolant. And what Hyundai have found is this coolant is sort of crystallizing in the system, and when I say system, I think it's actually in the battery pack, because all the channels going through this lot are all sort of 1-inch hoses, but I would imagine in the battery pack it's a much smaller gauge. And what they found is this coolant crystallizes, causing these solids, and the system has to be drained, flushed through many times to get any debris out, and then they're using a different coolant. So originally this coolant was called a BSC1, It's a low conductivity coolant, and they've now changed to something that's called a BSC2. The thing that's quite annoying though is they kept the colour the same, so you can't tell by looking at the colour whether you've got the new coolant or the old coolant. This car also has a heat pump, so you've got your air conditioning lines here, and you've got various chillers like at the back there. So the way a heat pump works is it uses the air conditioning compressor to both cool the car and heat the car. So let's just get the torch on there and we can look down the front, and you've got your hoses going into your motor stack there, and that unit there that I'm shining the torch on, I guess, is the water pump, or maybe it's a three-way diverter valve, but it's probably the water pump, but it's different to the pump they use on the Ioniq. There's a lot more hoses at the back on this than the Ioniq 38, but you've got your brake reservoir there, you've got your brake systems at the back there, you've got your air conditioning top up high there and low at the back, so that could easily be missed. They usually put them together or nearby anyway. So yeah, I think that's about all I can show you under here. Obviously we've got fuse box there, that's all bog standard. Access to the lights is quite good, but I have a feeling these are LED, so you're not going to be changing any of those. And access to this bottom one, yeah, you're going to have to access that through the wheel arch liner, because it is very low down. The only thing in reality that you're going to open the bonnet for, if you've got a Kona, is just filling up the windscreen washer bottle there. And then the other thing you need to do is occasionally check your coolant level, and on this case it is below the maximum, so that needs topping up, but it is still well above the minimum, and on this case the minimum is just below the sort of crease there in the bottle. The sticker is up there showing you what refrigerant you use in the air conditioning system, and it's R1234YF. So that's the more environmentally friendly refrigerant that all EVs use. All modern EVs beyond about 2016, something like that. And ICE vehicles are now using that as well. But this takes 1,000 grams, so a kilogram of refrigerant, plus or minus 25. So that is an awful lot, but that's what you typically find on vehicles that have got a heat pump. So I've just put the cover back on. The final thing I'll just say while we've got the bonnet open here is obviously EVs don't require much cooling. So that's why EVs don't have a grill at the front, because they don't need much airflow through the radiator. It still takes in air at the bottom through the lower grills, and that's forcing air through the radiator at the front here. They often have quite large radiators still, but I'm guessing that's because the radiator is the same as the combustion engine vehicle version of this car. But while the motor and the charger and inverter units are all water cooled, they're not getting particularly hot, and that's why you don't need this huge amount of airflow through the front of the vehicle. So now let's just have a look underneath. So the first thing you notice when you're looking under an electric vehicle is the battery pack, and obviously it takes up majority of the floor pan between the axles, and also how flat they are, which helps with aerodynamics. But on this car, this is a 64 kilowatt hour battery pack. These Konas are quite small vehicles, and the battery pack starts there and it goes the full length of the vehicle right to the back axle. So yeah, it's a huge battery in a small car. The other thing you notice is how much this battery pack hangs down. There's actually not much ground clearance under a Kona, and that's because this platform is also a combustion engine vehicle. It's not a bespoke EV platform. So when you get cars which are designed to be an EV, the battery sits much higher up in the bodywork, and it doesn't usually protrude much lower than the sills, but in this case it is protruding quite a bit more. Actually, let's get a tape measure and measure the ground clearance. And it's 15.5 centimetres. That's nothing to particularly worry about though, because it's the same at the front here with this under tray as well. This particular car has had a replacement battery a couple of years ago, because these batteries are made by LG Chem, and they had an issue with them, and some of the Konas and all the GM bolts in America got recalled because they use the similar cells or the same cells. So this battery was replaced about 2 years ago under the warranty in that mass recall. So the battery is one unit, one big pack. As I've shown you, there's nothing under the boot here behind the rear axle, unlike the Ioniq. Looking at the rear here, the rear suspension, there's nothing special here. It's all bog standard stuff. This car is rather muddy though. Got electric handbrake on these, so there's your actuator up there. But yeah, it's all looking pretty standard on the back, as you'd expect. And then going down to the front of the car, there's not much to see here really, because I'm not going to take these under trays off just to make this video, because I have no need to get under here for anything else. And these 10mm bolts can often snap. Well, the captive spring nut things on the back usually rust up and snap, so I don't want to end up opening a can of worms taking these trays off just to film the underside of the motor stack, because all we'll see here is the electric motor and the reduction gearbox. But that's all very similar to the Ioniq videos I've done, so if you want to have a look at those, I'll put a link at the top of the screen here and in the video description below. The other thing I've just noticed here, looking at the front where you've got your air intake here around the radar unit, is these have got active flaps in. So by default there is no air going into here at all, and then these will open, which normally you can spin them, but anyway, these will open when it requires that cooling and an airflow through the radiator. So I think that's all I'm going to cover in this video. I apologize for not taking these under trays off, but the car's only here to change the tyres, which I've just done, so I just don't want to open a can of worms by taking those trays off and ending up replacing snapped bolts and things, because sometimes they can be a right pain when they break and you've got to get an angle grinder in there and cut them. So out of the workshop now, we've got some daylight and we can see under here much better. So let's just pull this off again. And now we can see the orange cable here coming from the battery pack, a much thicker cable, disappearing down there to the battery pack. We can also see that water hose there, well, coolant hose should I say, the sort of browny coloured one because it's dirty, going, actually that looks like a water pump there, that's not the battery. So possibly that is a water pump at the back there as well. But anyway, that's the feed going into the coolant feed, or coolant line should I say, going into the battery pack. I can't see a return one, but it will be down there somewhere. But anyway, I'll finish off just showing you around in daylight. rack down there, of course. So as always, if you found this video interesting or useful, please do click the thumbs up button. That really does help. Do subscribe to the channel, and I'll see you on the next one.